Chapter 3. Miles to go, 115. I heard their footsteps behind me. It was more than one pair of shoes, and they were following me in the dark. I'd planned on letting Beau out of the duffel as soon as I was away from the restaurant, but I kept walking. I snuck a look over my shoulder. There were four or five of them. In the dark, they were just shadows following me. There was a low voice, some laughs. By the way they moved and sounded, I could tell they were teenagers. The direction I'd chosen was dark. The bar, the one my fake dad was at, was the other way, and ahead of me were only boarded up buildings and vacant lots. My anger was gone now. I walked faster. I heard a voice again, close enough this time that I could almost hear the words. There was an ugliness to the voice, half growl and half laugh. It was a voice that sounded like it was licking its lips. Beau wiggled in the duffel. I switched him to the other hand and tried to go faster. The pills had taken the edge off my headache, but they left my brain foggy and my stomach sick. I took deep breaths of the cool air to try and clear my thoughts and calm my belly. It didn't work. I got to another street, as empty and dark as the one I was on. To my left, a couple of blocks down, I could see some lights, some traffic. I turned and made my feet move faster. I was almost running. I looked over my shoulder, not bothering to be sneaky about it. They'd turned too. Ahead was a lone street light, casting a yellow circle of light onto the cracked sidewalk. It was only a good baseball throw away, but it looked like forever, with darkness all around and wolves behind me. I kept my eyes on the light and ignored my heaving lungs, my queasy stomach. I heard another laugh. It sounded like it was right behind me. "You've just got to make it to the light," I told myself. It was a stupid thing to think. That's the truth. "Hey, where are you going?" The voice was scratchy and taunting. I didn't stop, didn't dare look back. "Why are you going so fast? We can't keep up." It was a different voice, just as ugly. They all laughed. Beau growled. "We're talking to you, punk." There was a little grunt, and a rock whistled over my shoulder and bounced down the sidewalk. It rolled to a stop under the streetlight. I closed my eyes and kept walking. I knew already it was no use. I was 15 feet from the light when the footsteps started running. I knew from the shakiness in my legs and the burning in my lungs that I couldn't run, and that they'd catch me even if I could. They got me just as I stepped into the streetlight's yellow circle. An angry hand spun me around and another one grabbed my shirt. I dropped the duffel. "What's your problem, you little punk? Why won't you talk to me?" The face was pinched and pale and angry. It's all I saw. Dark, watery eyes. Eyebrows squeezed down and together. Red pimples on white skin. A mean mouth smiling like a shark. Sharp little teeth. His friends were lurking shadows behind him, moving to surround me. They were stupid laughs and shoving hands. They were everything bad and ugly and inescapable. I was alone, with them all around me. Tears sprang hot and salty to my eyes. It was too much. "Leave me alone," the kid snorted. "Leave you alone? Please." My voice squeaked through my tight and clenching throat. Sounded high and whiny. "Please," the kid said in a squeaky voice, mocking me. His friends laughed. "What you got in your backpack?" the kid asked, his voice dropping lower and getting more dangerous. I breathed out through my nose and closed my eyes. "You got any money?" I shook my head and tried to say no, but it just came out as a weak moan. My body was so tired. "Oh, I bet you do," the kid sneered. A hand tugged on my backpack. In the duffel at my feet, Beau growled. No one seemed to hear it but me. The hands pulled harder on my backpack. The straps dug into my shoulders. Mean chuckles and barks of laughter rang out around me. I tried to stand still, to stay on my feet. My stomach turned over and kicked. I swallowed. "Come on," the kid in front said. "Give it." I took a deep breath to slow my lungs. No, I said. My anger, chased away by fear, came slinking back. Go to heck. I gritted my teeth and closed my eyes to hold down the puke. The first fist hit me in the ribs. I doubled over, my breath gone. Two hands pushed me hard from the side. I tripped into two more hands, which pushed me back. No, I tried to say, but nothing came out. There was a final wrenching tug on my backpack. Another punch, hard and round and sharp, hammered my stomach. The world fell apart. I fell. The sidewalk was hard and sudden, concrete sandpaper that rushed up and smashed pain into my body. A foot crashed onto my stomach, another onto my back. I started to rise up onto my hands and knees, but a fist slammed into my cheek and shot the light out of my eyes. I didn't cry, but only because I was too scared and sick and hurt to. My backpack was ripped from my back. I didn't try to stop it. I felt with my feet for the duffel. It was still there. I didn't want them to open it. Bo was a small dog. I knew what they could do to him. I heard the zipper of my backpack buzz open. Nothing, the kid's voice said. Just a bunch of clothes and ropes and crap. Loser. What about his other bag? Another voice asked. No, I mumbled. Not Bo. My money. In my pocket. My face was pressed to the sidewalk, but they heard me. Hungry hands fed through my pockets. I felt the lump of my money slip out and away. Holy crap, the kid's voice whispered. There's like $100 here. Leave me some, I croaked, my voice hoarse and my breath short. What? Don't take it all. It's mine. Leave me something. The kid snorted. I'll leave you something, he said. A hand gripped my shoulder and turned me over onto my back. I opened my eyes in time to see the darkness of the night sky, then the fist flying toward me. It connected with my mouth with a meaty crunch that flashed bolts of pain through my body. My feet kicked out, my shoulders hunched, blood, warm and thick and salty, ran down into my throat. The pale face glared down at me, the glow of the streetlight behind it. I saw the eyes drop down to my camera, still around my neck. My hand shot up and grabbed it. The kid pulled at my fingers, tugged at the camera. I held tighter. Give it! No! I don't know if I said it or just thought it. My body was alive with pain. The kid pulled harder. I held tighter. He shook and yanked and my fingers turned to steel. I wasn't letting go. He gave a last rocking jerk and my hat tumbled off. I felt the cool night air on my head. The kid, his fist clenched back for another punch, froze. His eyes shot up to where my hat had been. God, he said, what's wrong with you? I blinked at him. You are, I said through my split lips. His mouth hung open, his fist slowly lowered. I lifted my camera and took a picture of him. Maybe he's got more, a different voice said. I heard a rustling at my feet, where my duffel was. I heard a zipper being drawn back. Bo was a small dog, but size doesn't tell you anything about how important something is. Bo came out of that duffel bag like hot burning justice, like all the right kinds of anger, like everything the world ever needed. He came out into the darkness and the blood of that cold city street fast and loud and hard, all teeth and bark and bravery. There were screams of surprise, shouts, curses, shrieks. Let's go! A voice shouted. I heard footsteps slapping quickly away into the night. The kid who'd punched me was still looking at me. I felt something flutter onto my heaving chest, and then he was gone, too, his footsteps joining the others, disappearing into darkness. I lay on the sidewalk, coughing, swallowing blood, and feeling all the different hurts in my body. There were plenty. Tears dripped hotly down my cheeks. The sidewalk was hard under my head. Rocks and pieces of gravel poked up at my back. I started to sit up, but stopped almost right away. I hurt too much in too many places. I dropped my head back to the sidewalk and looked through tear-blurred eyes up to where the stars should be. There weren't any. Clouds were hiding them, maybe, or they were lost in the lights of the city. I heard the click-clack of claws coming toward me. Bo. I hadn't noticed that he'd left. He'd chased them away. Away. And then he had come back to me. I felt his breath, his sniffing nose on my hand. Then on my neck, my bloody mouth, then loudly in my ear. I felt his tongue, soft at first, and then stronger as he got worried, licking at the blood and tears on my face. He whined, a quiet but urgent whine, and nudged me with his nose. I was still breathing, still staring at where the stars should have been, still feeling all my hurt and all my sad. And my dog was licking the blood and tears from my face. I turned my head to my dog, saw his eyes looking into mine, worried. One brown and one green. Felt his sniffing breath again, his warm tongue. A fresh batch of tears sprang to my eyes. Oh, Bo, I said. My voice was as scratchy as the concrete beneath my back. My words were blurry and muffled from the blood in my mouth and my split, swollen lips. He whined again, his breath hot in my face. He was on a dark street in a strange city far from his home, and he was worried only about me. He was my hero. I reached up painfully and scratched him behind the ears. His ears dropped and his tail wagged. I brought my hand down to my chest to feel what the kid had dropped there. My hand closed around it and held it close to my eyes so I could see it. A $20 bill. One of my $20 bills. I'd had five. He'd left me one. Here's what I don't get. Why people think I need help just because. I shoved the bill into my shirt pocket and closed my eyes again, let the tears burn out through my eyelids and down my face to the street. Bo shifted his paws nervously. He whined. I knew I should get up, find a restaurant or some place with a bathroom, get cleaned up. But I was just too sick, too sad, too hurt. I wanted to die right there on the sidewalk in a city that didn't care. All of my fight was gone. I reached out and grabbed the straps of my backpack and the handles of the duffel. I crawled away from the street, away from the light, deeper into the shadows, dragging them with me. My neck, my ribs, my head all protested as I scraped along the concrete. Jolts and jabs of pain rocketed around inside me. The taste of blood in my mouth was strong and bitter. Finally, I found myself against a brick wall. The lights from the street barely reached me. I didn't think any cars would be able to see me. Good. I didn't want someone to find me. I didn't want anyone to watch me die. I wanted to be alone. I curled up on my side, facing the wall. Bo stood for a second and then lay down against my back, watching over me. His body was warm. I closed my eyes and let myself die.